I will just pick up from saying, if you look at the documentation and even from the banner there, and noting that we are organizations that have, at least many of us, have worked on the electoral reforms issue for a very long time. We've either monitored elections, we candid political dialogue in the sense that what ails the system is not really more policy prescriptions, as Daisy raised earlier. We are very good at passing policies, that's clear. The issue is, where is the commitment and sincerity in articulating or executing the electoral governance system in a manner that ensures free, fair, credible, and peaceful elections? And the reality that we've come to is essentially that the incumbents have no real interest in a free, fair, credible election. And by incumbents, I mean across the board. Political actors who are in political power right now don't really have an investment in that. So what do we do as a country to push the agenda of that opening up for a free, fair, and credible election? So we synthesized what we consider to be key electoral issues as six. The leadership and governance in the management of elections, which is what has preoccupied the debate right now with regards to the fate of the commissioners. The issue of looking at all the allegations of impropriety, corruption that have bedeviled the commission, the loss of public confidence in the commission, as key issues that need to be discussed and the way out devised. The second issue is the credibility of the electoral governance process. And in this, we look at some of the issues that lend themselves into discrediting the electoral process. So the issues of the voter register, which has also been the subject of recent discussion, the management of the voter registration process, the use of technology in elections, and the management of the party nomination exercise are some of the issues that we focus on when we talk about the credibility of the electoral process. And so it's on that basis that we've been trying to engage on different levels. We've had numerous consultations, and it's also how we found ourselves engaging in the current context of the electoral reform debate, which is what I will center on as I endeavor to conclude in about 7 minutes. So we are all aware of what the Joint Select Committee of the Senate and the National Assembly had done. If you look at the scope of interest or their focus areas, they undertook their task in terms of dealing with the IEBC question on four thematic areas. And there's some resonance and some points of departure with the six issues that Kurango identifies with. So the main issue around what the Joint Select Committee has done is, while there may be resonance with some of the issues we've raised, the reality is what they have prescribed as solutions fall short of dealing with the core issue of free, fair, and credible elections in various respects. So, like, for example, when they started on their first thematic area to deal with the allegations against the commissioners of the IEBC, it's worth noting that they had no recommendation, actually, with regards to that question. And that their conclusion was, they made no findings on allegations against the commission and the secretariat with regards to all the issues of impropriety that they've been associated with, Chickengate being the most prominent one. Immediately, from Kurango's perspective, that presents a very huge challenge, because you cannot move forward with reforming this electoral process without an aspect of accountability for the misdeeds that have happened within the context of this IEBC. And that they would move forward in their second thematic area in terms of looking at the legal mechanisms of getting the commissioners to vacate office, that they can begin to negotiate an exit package that is devoid of the accountability question, mm-hmm. implicitly suggesting that there will be an immunity for these commissioners. It's a huge challenge, because you have to start asking what the legacy of this process then will be. Are we telling people that constitutional bodies can be held hostage by errant office holders, and that for them to then exit, you would have to negotiate their exit? And the other question you have to ask yourself is, because there's been a lot of, within the context of this debate, reference to Article 251 of the Constitution and how stringent the procedures are to get rid of commissioners in the state bodies. You have to ask yourself, was the intent of Article 251 to contradict the leadership and integrity chapter mm-hmm. of the Constitution? Is it an exclusive process that is the only way you can deal with the exit of errant office holders? because I would really shudder to think that you would have a process in the Constitution that then locks in errant behavior and then contradicts other significant aspects of the same Constitution. So the position of Kurangu Sotiangu has been to say that while everybody agrees that these commissioners have lost public confidence and they need to exit, you can't negotiate your way out of accountability for these processes. And then furthermore, you can't negotiate packages of payment to these commissioners for the remainder of their term for work they essentially will not be doing. And when you look at the other thematic area that, I think the other two thematic areas that the select committee focused on with regards to now dealing with what Kurangu would refer to as the credibility of the electoral process, those are the two areas that will form the substance of legislative changes in parliament. So they have proposed two bills. One bill that will be an electoral laws amendment bill that then goes on to move into the recommendations they made, for example, as to the audit of the voters register, to look at how they can then enhance the issue of the processing of vote results or election results, how they're transmitted, the use of technology in elections. And then there's the second bill, which is an election offences bill, that then seeks to enshrine some of the offences or consolidate electoral offences that are spread across different statutes into one statutory document, one law, that then can be easy to follow. But within that context, some of the issues I think, as I conclude, that I'll focus on in their recommendations is, as Kurangu Sotiangu, the thought of, or the proposition to audit a voter's register, in our opinion, falls short of what is actually required in that context. Because from 2013, you could see there were such inconsistencies on the discussion of the voter's register. We talked about our Green Book, we talked about what they had produced, the Black Book. There was then what was issued to political parties and other stakeholders just ahead of the election, form of the database on CDs. The reality is, what are you auditing essentially out of all those multiple representations of the voters register? I think the most prudent thing to do would be to move towards a clean registration process that dispenses with a voters register that has been highly contested and actually has lost credibility at every point of inquiry. So the more you ask about this register, the more it faces a credibility crisis. Then, of course, there's the issue that most parliamentarians focused on this week, and that was the recommendation on party hopping. So that you could see that the report was essentially adopted by the Senate, but then reached a sticky point in the National Assembly because of that one particular concern, rather than a broad conversation about the other recommendations. And so, for us moving forward, as Kurangu Sotiangu, the emphasis will be that we would still want to push the agenda of comprehensive electoral reforms from the context of a broad-based dialogue that incorporates the six key issues that we feel are at the heart of a credible electoral process. You will note that from some of the issues I've discussed from the JSC, they never touched on the issue of security. They never considered the issue of the two-third gender principle as a context of electoral reforms, and they didn't even really concern themselves effectively on the issue of coordination between the different state agencies within the election. So for us, we feel there is so much more that needs to be done with regards to reforming the electoral system ahead of the 2017 general elections, and we will continue to engage in form of several levels of consultations. And we will also, because at the heart of the ambition of Kurangu is for it to be a citizen-led coalition that is just coordinated effectively by several civil society organizations, we want to get this conversation to permeate at the different levels within society. And the hope is that we will be able to steer an agenda that course corrects what seems to be a very short prescription by the JSC to try and band-aid their way into the next election, rather than deal with the critical issues that have bedeviled several elections. I think it's only 2002 where we could safely say we had a non-contested electoral outcome. Yes, so I think I'll stop at that level there.
Well, so we are embarking on a marathon project. The audit. You've got now common ground. We have shared some of the thoughts, how to go about it. The process has been initiated. It will concretize, I hope, in the next few weeks, so that we can have the first assessment workshops.